YouTubers, and welcome to this T4D. So today, something a little different. I've got Chris Gammell with me. The first time I'm actually doing an interview with someone. So Chris, just quickly, who are you and what do you do right now?
Right now, I run a website called Contextual Electronics, where I teach people about how to design and build and troubleshoot electronics. And Martin's talked about it on T4D before. And I also run the Amp Hour, which is my co-host is Dave Jones. Probably a lot of people in the audience know that know who that is as well. But we have a weekly show about electronics where we do interviews. We've had Martin on,
exactly.
And so now we're trading off, and we're going to our hangout after this too. Yeah,
hangouts as well.
So I'm moving in tomorrow. into your basement. I'm just going to live down here. Yeah.
I mean, I owe a lot to obviously Dave Jones, because he actually jumped in as soon as he heard us coming to Cleveland. He jumped in and said, "If you're going to Cleveland, that's where.
Why are you going to Cleveland?
And he also introduced me to you. We jumped in, had a meetup at a pub.
Yep.
And then now, we're literally embroiled in meetups and the like.
Yep. It's great.
But when I saw you about a year ago, and I met you just over a year ago, and we were sitting in the pub, you were at that point in time working for ABB, weren't you?
Yes, that's right. ABB is a, like the GE of Europe is how I say it. It's the multinational, they do a lot of power stuff. Cool place to be, I liked it.
What were you doing at ABB?
I was designing a new set of measurement equipment for inside of power plants. So when you need to measure temperature of like a steam bath or so thermocouples, RTDs, that kind of thing. And then also just analog sensors. A lot of stuff still uses like 4 to 20 milliamp control and just sensors in general. Basically they have standard outputs, and so this was basically accepted a wide range of different inputs, and then you can map, you know, 5 milliamps is, you know, 100 PSI or something like that.
Yes. I've done quite a while ago when I was doing some work for Fluke agents in South Africa, they did PLC stuff what have you, and I did some videos on the instrumentation, so I know a little bit about it.
But
it's obviously a big area.
I was really surprised when I started there. I didn't realize how huge. I mean, it's everywhere though. It's every power plant, it's every industrial facility, so good stuff.
And now prior to ABB, you were at
Keithley Instruments. Yes. Now part of Danaher, which is Tektronix and Fluke. So yes, part of the megalith.
And what are you doing there?
I was doing, I was working on a bunch of older equipment, kind of sustaining it and doing small improvements on it. Stuff like electrometers, 6517B. Current sources, like a lot of the more specialized equipment, nanovolt meters, 2182, stuff like that.
Okay.
And kind of just mostly learning. I mean, honestly, that was a lot of what I was doing, but kind of sustaining engineering type stuff.
And then your area of expertise there, I mean, at some point in time, I know we're not going to have time today, but at some point in time, I'm going to drag you back here to do analog to digital convert.
Oh yeah, we're talking about doing that. Yep.
Because that's an area which obviously, I presume from Keithley, that's an area where you gained a fair bit of experience.
Yeah, some of that. I mean, just, but also every project, you know, with anything with analog, you have to eventually get it back to a computer these days. Yeah. So it's good stuff to know, and you got to learn it eventually.
And then from ABB, you decided to take a big step and a jump, quite a courageous one, because you were doing, you obviously had your own YouTube channel. You were doing videos.
Yeah, sort of. Not like yours, but yeah.
No. But you're still doing videos. Yeah. And then you decided to jump in and really go at it and start Contextual Electronics. Mm-hmm. And I've obviously mentioned Contextual Electronics a couple of times to people on T4Ds and that kind of thing. But just explain what you still do in Contextual Electronics.
So we do, it's 2 8-week courses. First 8 weeks is designing using KiCAD, which is an open source PCB software, which I'm going to be pushing on Martin to use for the power supply project. And then also, you know, like picking out parts, like a lot of the stuff that's just that I really struggled with, especially when I got the Keithley. You know, I had worked in a fab for 2 years at Samsung, and I didn't do any electronics in that whole time. So I kind of had to relearn all this stuff. And there was a lot of struggle, like especially learning the really advanced, you know, work with a lot of advanced people. I really struggle with stuff, so it was kind of Contextual Electronics is trying to figure out how to do that, how to start building your own boards. It's a big leap to get from, you know, building your first kit, or even, you know, before that, even just like looking at a, you know, a transistor on a page and trying to do the math behind it, to actually having something working on a bench, on a PCB, in a product, you know, it's like all these different levels and all the things that you need to do to get there.
Yes. And so, I mean, as a novice, as I've noted before, just when you're trying to go and find the parts and understand the packages and what's going on there, that can be very intimidating.
Yeah.
So that's where the other piece of your work then jumps in. So on, how is your time split at the moment? Half your time is set to doing contextual electronics and your own thing, and now the other half of your time, who do you work for?
It's a Supplyframe, and I work there on a new search engine we're releasing next week, actually. It's called parts.io, and it's basically, my whole role there is trying to fight for the engineer, and like, because it's so hard, like there's a lot of different people in the business, right? There's buyers and purchasers that have very specific needs. There's the vendors who have very specific needs and are obviously, you know, paying to have their stuff included, that kind of thing. But, you know, it's tough for the engineers, even with like the existing, the DigiKeys, the Mausers, the Newark, stuff like that. It's just hard to, you know, you put in a search term and sometimes it's really hard to not only get what you need, but then figure out what you're looking at.
Yes.
And so my whole thing is there has been trying to make it so that it's not just a place you can find the information when you know what you're looking for, but also moving towards what happens when you don't know what you're looking for,
yes, yet,
right? I mean, that is the, that is really, really hard when you're shopping for a new component. Maybe you know you need an op amp, right? Okay, let's go through, we can start filtering, do that kind of stuff. But that's really confusing when you're starting out. And then sometimes you don't even know if you need an op amp. Like, the example I always give is, there's a class of new class of chips called analog front ends, right? And that's like what we use in contextual electronics. It's this great chip, the MCP3901. It's this two-channel, A to D built-in, front-end amplifier, all this other stuff. It's got a spy bus. Like, it's really a great little chip for like $3. But if you went and searched for that, you're like, oh, I need to measure stuff, right? There's no way to just get measure stuff, because you'd have to either go towards op amps or towards analog to digital converters or towards this new field that doesn't exist yet. So it's trying to get everything, and that's, so that's what I'm trying to work on right now.
And then obviously the other biggest thing, which we had lunch recently, and you kindly brought along your what you're working on to kind of get some input.
Yeah.
And Michael was there. That's a gent who does Arduino. He's got his own channel. And we're saying from like from a novice point of view, the one thing where I have made this mistake a couple of times, you go, you get a part, you see this nice big icon or thumbnail, and you think, oh yes, that's something I can work on. And suddenly the pitch of the part gets to you. And
it shows up. Ah, holy crap, where's my microscope?
I can't do that. And that's something we said that would be really cool if you've got some guideline in that as well. And that's what you're hoping to actually do as well.
Yeah, a lot of, I mean, it's, I'm working with a great software team and a lot of people who knew search and great web design stuff. So I'm really excited about what that's going to be.
Classic.
So there'll be, there's signups now, but people will be able to like access them like a month or two. So, and actually get in there and start giving feedback and stuff like that, so.
Done, okay. So you must let me know, because I'm
of course.
A lot of the audience, that's the kind of thing that they face all the time. So we'll jump in and ask them to actually go and have a look.
Right, and it's all happening in Cleveland.
And it's all happening in Cleveland.
Not really, I work in California, but sometimes, but. So but there's three of us now, and there's more at the pub waiting tonight, so.
I mean, that's what's quite hectic. I mean, you probably, I mean, did you have any inkling how hectic your life is going to be in terms of travel? Because this new role has suddenly shot you around the country. You're traveling all over the place.
Yeah. I asked for it, but I'm kind of, it's different now.
It's different.
Yeah.
And then we've got our meetups. And that's I must say, the other thing I'm beginning to realize. I mean, I know we kind of started out with meetups thinking it'd just be a fun thing to do as an excuse to get out socially. And if there are people there, right. But I'm realizing the value of actually bringing like minds just together, just to chat. I mean, the amount of information I've gleaned from people going out socially has been absolutely brilliant.
Yeah, well, especially these days, like, you know, I'm big, I love using Twitter and stuff like that, but nothing, like, especially like at conferences, you start meeting up with people that you talk to online a lot, people that are already working the same kind of stuff you are, the same interests, and then maybe they have other interests, they introduce other people that finally come together after meeting a lot of people online. And it's just that focused group of like people who give a crap about what I give a crap about.
Yes.
Like, you don't get that anywhere else.
Yeah.
You know? So it's nice when you can It happens more in big cities. Yeah. It's tougher in Cleveland. And I got a lot of people, like probably a lot of people watching are in smaller towns. I remember there's one guy for Contextual Electronics. He's like, yeah, you know, I'm in this tiny town in like northern Sweden. And I'm like, what? It's just like, you know, it's just him. And it's, there's a lot of people like that. So online's good, but if you can get to a conference or something like that and meet people, it's even better, I think.
Yeah.
So you show off stuff.
So the next thing we're going to talk about, which you've provided some handy input as well as a good gent Peter, is obviously my power supply project. Mm-hmm. Now before we get onto the bench, because I know I've literally just been working on videos, and I know I haven't properly in my own mind perhaps explained the output side on the voltage adjustment. Now the one tool I hadn't thought of work using, and you mentioned, was obviously LTspice. Mm-hmm. Is that something that you use regularly? Have you found value in it? I mean, my natural thought is, can a computer program naturally, could I put the design of my power supply in there and really emulate what's going on?
Yeah, it's kind of a double-edged sword. It's like, so Spice is great because you can try a lot of stuff. And when the current goes to 1,000 amps, you know, that won't actually happen here. It'll just start smoking, right? Yeah. But then that kind of thing is great because it allows you to kind of play around and not break anything. But you do have to balance it between, you know, stuff on the bench, trying it out. It's good for like small stuff and trying to, I really like it for, you know, small sub circuits. When I started out, I would always build, you know, get a schematic and I'd be like, U1, you know, R1, and you build the whole thing out, and then you click go, you're like, oh, well, why isn't this working, you know?
Yeah.
And you have to do it in pieces, and that's what I learned that from a lot of the guys at Keithley, is like, you have to do small pieces, and what that ultimately means is that you have to start to conceptualize what are the pieces in the first place, right?
Yes.
Viewing these two resistors, they're not just two resistors, it's acting as a voltage divider, right? I can replace stuff with modular blocks and stuff like that.
I was gonna say, so just before we started recording, you talked about blocks, so we're looking at this and you're talking about literally breaking down things literally to blocks and what they do.
Yeah.
Because that adds a far easier way to actually go and troubleshoot.
Right, and once you start, and so I kind of like talk about like seeing the matrix too, like when you start like especially when you start with op-amps, that was a really tough thing for me when I was starting out, but like a standard configuration is like a non-inverting op amp, you know, you got a feedback resistor and input resistor going to the negative and non-inverting terminal. And like, at first you're just trying to figure that out, how it works, and then you kind of start to figure that out. But what ultimately happens is that over time you start seeing these patterns emerge, right? You see that same thing, you're like, oh, that's an inverting configuration. And then you can kind of zoom out and you say, I don't have to worry about this anymore. I know the gain of this block is probably -2, and let's move on to the next thing, right?
Yeah.
And you kind of just start to block things out. And that's when reading schematics gets a lot easier.
Okay.
Like when we were talking about the power supply the other day, I saw the current source right away, right? That's feeding into the zener, right?
Yes.
I didn't know the math behind it.
No.
Right? But I just knew, that's probably the current source. And that's, you have to kind of start seeing these blocks and even saying, I don't care what it is right now, just so you can kind of, in your mind, you kind of throw it away and say, I'll get back to it. And then when you need to, you can dig in, do a spice simulation just for that one block, and then you can really understand.
Yeah, because I can, especially folks like me, novice, if you're looking at the circuit and just seeing components, your mind just goes,
I know. So especially if someone's drawn it bad, and like you're using left to right, and someone goes right to left, where? You know, and it's just, you can't do anything about it.
My first, literally, when I was tracing it from the actual original, my first, because I was literally tracing the original, also, conceptually not thinking, okay, definitely make the top rail perhaps your positive and a ground rail down here, input on the one side, output on the other, and if you don't do that and you're trying to make head or tail of it, you don't,
it's
help,
just like squiggly lines.
It's squiggly lines, and also you don't help anyone else who's got to try and look and decipher what's going on.
My friend used to draw, my friend Keithley, he and I would do a obfuscated circuit contests, where he would draw like a crazy circuit, and then we'd have to try and figure out what it does. And basically, he started from a regular circuit and he just kind of just moved stuff around. And it would have worked.
Yes.
But it's really tough. It becomes difficult so quickly. When you start moving outside of those constructs that you're used to, you know, it's just, you know, well, I guess that's something.
So that's a challenge, and I'm going to probably do is I'm going to put that in LTspice, because that might actually make it a lot easier to I mean, the scary thing is, I'm sure if you like, if you look at the bench right now and the spaghetti mess, and I'm trying to film and show people different points on the circuit and what's happening, it might be a good time to actually break away sometime and go, here we go, just changing this is what's going to happen instead of,
I know one of the members of Contextual Electronics I work with on a personal basis too, and she actually also, when she's doing breadboard stuff, she'll do fritzing, and that helps to break stuff up and helps to draw out where the stuff should be on the PCB, or on the breadboard rather, and that's great. I mean, I actually never used that when I was coming up through and learning, but it's a great tool for that, you know, especially for breaking stuff up and for assembly and checking, and because nothing's worse when you have you're on a breadboard, you're like one square over. And,
been there, done it. Yeah, yes.
It's tough, but you have to get a feel for the whole circuit first, and then be like, when you start troubleshooting, you have to kind of have these error checks in your head. You're like, oh, well, this should be roughly 3 volts. Is it 3 volts? Yes, it is. Then you throw it away, because another thing that I did, and I continually do, is like when you get in this troubleshooting loop and you're like, I'll check this point, it's 3 volts. Do this other stuff. Oh, I should check this point, it's 3 volts. Yeah, then do this other stuff. Yeah, I should check this. I've checked this so many times now! You know, like you have to be systematic about it at a certain point, and that really, the tools that help for that can really make your life less painful.
Yeah. So. Now, before we actually get down and explain that output, I have committed to giving KiCAD a bash to see how it works. Because I've been using DesignSpark.
Yeah, that's a good tool too, yeah.
I mean, probably second or third time using it, I'm starting to get used to the actual quick keys. And that's probably the when you start getting to know the shortcut keys, that's when things start happening a lot quicker.
Yeah.
Now, have you used Eagle?
I used Eagle a lot, actually, at Keithley. Yeah, anytime I was doing a test board or anything.
So you've done Eagle. You're obviously mainly a KiCAD man at the moment. Have you used DesignSpark?
I've tried DesignSpark.
Initial impressions?
It's clean. I mean, it's. Okay. I think it's a little limited, but it's clean.
Okay. And,
I've tried Altium. I've used Altium with that. Ooh. Oh. Yeah. That's not deep. It's just a deep. I mean, that's just a. But once you know it, you love it.
You love it. So if a novice is doing something like this, you would err towards KiCAD for this?
No, I would not. No, because I would say you never should start here. You should start with a simple project first. I mean, for KiCAD, the thing that I did is I did a getting to blinky is like this.
Yep.
So you should have some kind of, I think you should do this in every program, is you should have a test board that you do. So I did a design, it was a 1 by 1 inch by 1 inch PCB, it's just a 555 blinking circuit.
Yeah.
You should do that in every program, because then you have to do at least one footprint, one schematic symbol, you have to do layout, you have to do the output stuff. Do that by itself first.
And then you'll get a feel.
Because if you do it here, and you're already struggling with just, man, I don't even know if I should hook up this transistor to this resistor kind of thing, and then you're also struggling with the software itself, you have to decouple that, I think.
Yeah.
It becomes really difficult if you're trying to do everything at once.
Okay.
So.
Anyway, that's my challenge. Try and look at all three of them and just see what actually, from a novice point of view.
I mean, and there's a lot of options out there. I mean, like, some people will try Upfers, another good one. I mean, Upfers is out there. And like you said, Eagle, I mean, a lot of people like that because there's a lot of libraries out there. It's kind of just about how much people want to dive in, I obviously love KiCAD, so. And KiCAD.info, we have forums over there at forums.kiCAD.info.
Yes.
So, if there are questions.
Throw it in there.
Yeah.
Right, so next we're going to jump into and have an explanation on the voltage side output, which I don't think I've done a good explanation on.
Okay.
So pull up that. Right, so what Chris is going to demonstrate is something that I don't think I've explained very well, is in terms of the voltage control and how that is done by the op amp controlling the voltage output. This diagram I've used where I kind of display the kind of drops against the various components like the power transistor and the two voltage dividers, but Chris is going to simplify it somewhat.
So one thing that, I drew it here. We'll get to what this is. I kind of like redrawing stuff, and I highly recommend that people redraw when they're trying to conceptualize stuff. But it can be, like, this is kind of what I was talking about.
like right now, this whole orange part right here, this output driver stage, I redrew this as a voltage controlled current source, and I could talk about that. And then the output here I drew as having an actual load resistor. It could be something high, right? We could say it's like 100K, right? Not a big deal. Doesn't have to be like a low resistance load that's drawing a bunch of current. It's just, there's always gonna be some resistance out there. And even if there is literally no resistance out there, there's a capacitor there, which you can think about like a resistor in time.
Yep.
So the other things I drew, right? So we talk about, right here, this is the reference section, right? So a current source, a Zener diode, and just a regular diode. I just drew that now as a voltage source. And I drew it as two volt voltage reference or voltage source, just for the math to make it nice and easy. And then the op amp here, right? Because this is ultimately what we're talking about, is the voltage sense amplifier. So again, this part here is this section right here, this and the resistor here, right? We basically set it to about 2 volts. We have the op amp. Then we have the output stage over here, and then we have the actual output pins, and then a feedback section is what we're talking about here. So when we get started, the other difficult thing about getting started with this stuff is that it happens over time. So when you start with everything, everything's at 0 volts, right? You have 0 volts across here. You have 2 volts here. We'll say that this is 0 volts here. I'm not going to call it ground, but you can think about it like ground if you want to. So 0 volts, 2 volts, 0 volts, right? 0 volts, and 0 volts.
Yep.
Okay. So time starts. It sees 2 volts here. It sees 0 volts here. All it wants to do is get this higher, right? So it says, this is too low. I want to get this higher. How do I do that? I make this higher, right? And really, if we start looking at a graph of this, right? So this is going to be time. And this is the output voltage here. This is going to spike up as high as it can get, right? So now the voltage here, we'll say for the sake of argument, we'll call this 20 volts, right? 20 volts here, 20 volts here, right? And now basically this current source turns on, right? So this is going to start basically allowing some of the current from this 30 volt rail to start flowing towards the output. Now I know that when you get started in electronics especially, it's so tough to start thinking about things in terms of current, but that was the big switch for me. That was like, once I started figuring that out, everything gets easier because there's always current flowing. Even when you think you have no current flowing, there's always leakage current, there's something like that. So this is turned on now. Now some of the current from this 30 volts is flowing down through this output stage, right?
Yep.
And now it's flowing through our output. And very quickly, it doesn't take much current, right, through a 100K resistor to get this to a higher voltage. So now I'm gonna draw this, so we'll call this, what was it? We'll call this point A, right?
Yeah.
We'll call this point B. B is here, right? So now, same thing happens, right? This goes up, current goes up, right? And now this goes up to some voltage that we don't know what it is yet, right? As this starts to approach a voltage yet to be named, right? Right now this still sees 2 volts.
Yep.
This now hits 6 volts, right? 6 volts, right? This hits 6 volts here. Now we can talk about this feedback path, right? So now we have these two resistors, right? These 39K and an 18K create a divide by 3 block all together, right? You can see this is touching here, and then this is going to the bottom path here, but really what it means is that this point right here is 1/3 of the voltage at the output, and that's that block thinking that I was talking about before. So now if we draw point C right here, now this might be 6 volts, this gets up to 2 volts. Okay, yeah. So we're at 2 volts now, right? Now this is no longer 0 volts. This is 2 volts, right? The op amp, all it does is keeps looking at his inputs. Am I happy? Am I happy? I'm not happy. Okay, now I see 2 volts here, 2 volts here. Now, this can go back. Actually, it's not going to be that. It's going to go back to some other voltage, not 0 volts necessarily, probably somewhere between 0 and 20 volts, right? Mm-hmm. It goes as high as it can, but then there's something called steady state. So maybe at 5 volts, so 5 volts here now, is what keeps just enough current flowing out of here to flow down through here to make the voltage here, to make the voltage here, to make this happy.
That makes sense, because in some of the measurements I was doing, there was a voltage coming out of the op amp, and I couldn't, it happened to be 7 volts in the case.
Yeah.
And I was thinking, why 7? Why isn't it going down to ground?
Exactly.
Why? Okay.
Yeah, it's the ultimate thing, and this is another tough part, it doesn't matter, right? Yeah. The output of an op amp, like I've looked at so many diagrams, especially at Keithley, where there's a lot of like weird control system stuff, and it was just like I was looking at this output and it was scope after scope trace after scope trace, and it didn't make any sense to me. And eventually I'm like, just leave it alone, you know, like it, because that ultimately what it's going to do is going to do whatever it needs to get there.
Yeah.
And so the best thing to do is to check your inputs. And if one input is not high enough, then you kind of go back through and you say, well, why isn't this one high enough? Oh, I put the wrong resistor in here, right? And so this isn't the right divider, right? Or maybe my load isn't quite what I think it is, right?
Yeah.
So now we have 6 volts at the output. We have 2 volts at point C. That's happy because that's happy, right? And this has found some steady state here, right?
Gotcha.
So this is point A is here. And that's basically all it is. That's all it takes. Now, the confusing thing is when you start going in, and the reason to think of this as a current source, this is something me and Martin did on the first take, which is what makes it very, very difficult, right? Is, okay, so now we change our reference here, and not really even our reference, but our divided voltage here, right? Because this is an adjustable voltage.
Yep.
Now we turn this down to 1 volt. Okay, so now it's two volts here, 1 volt here. It says, I want to get this down to 1 volt. How do I do that? Well, I go as low as I can, and which in this case would be 0.
Yeah, okay, gotcha.
The difficult thing here is that this is the only way this circuit works is in one direction, right? It can turn this on and it can turn it off. I guess that's two directions, but it can't drive it negative. It can't drive it to a negative 30 volt rail, which is how some more advanced power supplies work. So instead, and the reason to think about this as a voltage source, or current source rather, is, okay, so now this point is too high, right? And it wants to get down to 1 volt. How does it do it? Well, it turned itself off at point A, right? So now this is 0 volts.
Right.
And this is what me and Martin were struggling with before too. Now this is 0 volts, and by itself, because now you turn off the tap to this current source faucet, this will naturally drop down, I guess point B will drop back down to some lower voltage, right?
Yeah.
Right? And so, and we can calculate what that's going to be. It's going to be 3 volts. Now, how do we know that? We know that because point B is going to go back through a divide by 3 block. Right, and then this will become 1 volt, right? This will go follow the same kind of path. Now this is at 1 volt, sorry for my terrible handwriting. And now, once again, this thing is happy, right? It's all about how happy is your op amp, right?
Exactly.
Happy wife, happy life, happy op amp, happy. But this is really the key thing there, is that thinking about this entire output section as one big current source. And if we start digging into it, really what it is that, you know, it's a current source here. You're basically turning this current source on and off,
yeah,
which is turning this on or off, which is acting as a source on the way out.
Gotcha.
And that's a big part of, especially doing like transistor-based design, you have to make that switch over to current control and everything else.
Okay. So then my next question to you is, you obviously have got used to breaking this down into blocks. I've got no industry experience, so as to that's my problem, is you're kind of looking at individual components.
Yeah.
So where is this, if you sitting in Keithley and they're talking about design, where did this come from for you? Is it something out of working in industry at Keithley or something, or?
You know, it was, but it was actually because I had people that kind of on the same level as me, and we would do the same thing. We'd sit at a whiteboard. It's been a while, like I said, but
yeah,
you get these mantras, and you start to kind of like, you start to repeat these things to yourself, and you it's all based on these first principles that, you know, some of it's math-based, right? But also some of it is just kind of knowing these, seeing these things, seeing these patterns over and over again.
Yeah.
So unfortunately, some of it is just not going to be, it's just experience, right?
Yeah.
It's just going to be,
yeah.
People are going to learn at their own pace. You have to be patient, right? You took me a long time. Like,
yeah.
It really did. So, but I think, you know, your channel, Dave's channel, I think that stuff like that really it helps to break stuff down. So, and I highly, highly, highly recommend that people redraw schematics themselves, right? Get a piece of paper, draw it yourself, right? Or get a whiteboard, because then you can redo it a lot, because you can start breaking it down more, and you can say, well, what is the real point of this, right? So like the stuff you did here is really good for the blocks, right? That's good because that helps to separate things out.
Yes, now that was thanks to Peter, because again, that was what pulled it together for me.
Yeah.
Was my, I mean, I'll get my original drawing just for humor.
Okay. Oh boy.
Oh boy.
Oh boy. Oh, that's not that bad.
So, but that is what I originally traced out from having to look at and lift and test continuity. And I've mentioned before, that was my mistake. I was trying to repeat, you've got some low resistant paths, and so your continuity buzzer goes off, and you think two paths are linked, and they're not.
There's something
with low resistance in between.
You turn on a diode or something, yeah.
So, but this is how I kind of initially pulled it together. And then the first, after I got that,
You put it into like a CAD program or
something? Then I put it into a CAD program, but it still wasn't really logically laid out.
Right, but you recognize at least transformer goes into a bridge, goes into capacitors.
Yeah, those basics, yes, I did manage to get right. But certainly the rest of it, breaking up what was driving the current and the voltage. And so, I mean, I knew that this circuitry basically hung together, but when you present it, and that's where people with experience, someone like Peter and other folks, just look at it and go, hang on.
Yep. Block, block, block.
Block, block, block.
Yep.
And it makes a lot of logical sense.
Yeah. Yeah. It's tough, yeah. And then going from this to something that's even more conceptual, right? So thinking about an output stage as a current source, right?
Yes.
But even we were struggling, but as you'd explain it, you know? And that's ultimately the test too, is if you can explain it to someone else, that's usually a test that you know it, right? So.
Yeah. Chris, thank you. So that makes a lot of sense in terms of breaking it down. I am at some stage gonna drag you back, because I know I've gone and look, I mean, I'm fascinated by measurement equipment and the whole realm of taking things from analog to digital for measurement equipment.
Yep.
And there, I mean, I've gone and watched some tutorials on YouTube, and there's definitely an art to understanding it. It can get down, broken down to very basic bits and pieces, but that is an area you know. So I'm going to definitely try and drag you back for that kind of thing.
Yeah. Definitely. Well, it's good. Excellent. I mean, this is good stuff, and it's good to, you know, it's good to kind of break it down into these pieces and really, you know, it's good that you were doing it on a breadboard as well. That always helps to be able to probe and have all that stuff and swap things out. So,
Chris, thank you very much.
Yeah.
We almost have to go and do our meetup. And again, I can strongly suggest that wherever you are, if you can get together with like-minded people, start hearing about these things and discussing, because sometimes when you're locked alone by yourself, you just get caught up in a situation where you just cannot see it. And I know, whether it is literally going out to lunch with Chris or having some interaction with Peter, it certainly opened things right up for me. So, classic.
Yeah, and then if you don't find one, start one. That's another big thing.
That, good point. Because Dave Jones is going to start one in Australia soon.
Yeah, so he says. Yeah.
Brilliant. Thanks very much. Thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you very soon for the next video. Cheers.